A identidade goesa é um tema que os goeses têm apaixonadamente debatido nos mídias, nas conversas de café, nas publicações. Porquê? Ao longo deste programa vamos tentar responder a essa pergunta, se é que isso é possível, mas pelo menos tentar encontrar algumas respostas. Vamos, de uma forma geral, contextualizar em termos históricos, tentar, em termos históricos, descobrir porquê Goa chegou a um ponto em que a identidade se tornou um tema tão apaixonante e depois focar-nos nos últimos 47 anos, nos anos em que Goa já não é uma colónia portuguesa e é um Estado, o 25º e o mais pequeno Estado da União Indiana. A primeira abordagem de resposta é fácil. Basta olharmos em redor e vermos quão fértil é a terra de Goa e quão rodeada por água está. Naturalmente, é uma natural rede de transportes e é um fantástico porto. Foi primeiro cobiçado pelos muçulmanos, que daqui fizeram um porto de venda de cavalos. É um ponto estratégico entre o sul e o norte, o oriente e o ocidente, entre as rotas marítimas e as rotas terrestres. E depois vieram, em 1510, os portugueses conquistaram Goa, foi a primeira colónia do Império Colonial Português, e fizeram Goa, de novo, um entreposto comercial, um entreposto de difusão da língua e da religião. E, portanto, ao longo destes... E hoje temos a União Indiana, que trouxe o hinduísmo e trouxe mais línguas. Isto é, ao longo destes últimos séculos, Goa sofreu a influência de várias religiões, de várias línguas, de várias culturas, de várias identidades e, de uma forma muito curiosa, sendo sempre governada por estranhos que asseguravam a sua defesa e o seu comércio externo, de uma forma muito curiosa, tentaram sempre preservar a sua identidade. E, principalmente nos últimos 47 anos, e é sobre isso que nos vamos especificamente debruçar neste programa, bateram o pé e em três momentos históricos disseram: não, nós somos goeses e queremos continuar a ser goeses e queremos continuar a ter a nossa língua, o nosso território, a nossa cultura. Espero que nos acompanhem nesta pesquisa sobre porquê em Goa se tornou tão apaixonante o tema a identidade.
Presently we are in a big moment fighting for the very existence of Goa, the very existence of Goan identity, which is part of our natural heritage, the natural beauty that we inherited, our hills, our signature coconut tree, our fields, our language, our rivers, everything is under grave threat. And this time the threat is not from a colonial power, or it is a threat from the rest of the country. I'm sad to say this, but that is a fact. And there have been moments in the history of Goa, especially post-liberation of history of Goa, where we fought for our identity and we made it possible. For example, the opinion poll of 1967, which took place on 16 January 1967, where we fought for our identity, we fought for Goa as a separate entity. We were the anti-mergerist. And we said that we want to preserve our language, that is Kokani, our mother tongue. We said that we want to preserve Goa as a separate entity and not to merge with the neighboring state of Maharashtra. And that, I feel, was a huge watershed year in the history of Goa. And there have been struggles after that. There has been the 1986 struggle for language, that is Kokani, which finally culminated Kokani into getting into the 8th schedule of the constitution on 20th August 1992. That again was a great moment in the history of Goa.
Say Portuguese was here in about 450 years in Portuguese. It's a long tradition it was there. They imposed Portuguese, but they imposed their cultural, so Portuguese culture. So we not accepted that much. Still we maintain our identity with language. They tried to destroy the Konkani, but they can't do it. Then say, okay, you continue with Konkani, but you written in the Roman script. It is familiar to those people, Portuguese people were very familiar to Roman script. So our Konkani people accepted the Roman script, but for language of Konkani. Language was Konkani, but written in Roman script. That is there, and they think. But they preserve their language. Even they change our religion, but not change the culture. I will give one, it is a very interesting thing in folklore. There is a festival of Dhalo. It is a festival of Dhalo, particular by the woman folk, Goan folk, woman. And it was Dhalo was totally sung by gods, prayer of the gods. That is one incident is there. They said, Rathat ucho ghudiyo sade tinshi daniyo rathat kona deva basege. It is a rath, the goddess, car of the god, and god is sitting on the car. And flag are there. And who is sitting in the chair? Rath. Rathat base shanta durga janaloka disege, janaloka disege. In their cart, shanta durga goddess is there. Shanta durga is the original goddess of Hindu. Shantadurga goddess. It was continue at our village. Suddenly they converted into Christianized, those people, that woman folk. And next year, total Dhalo was continuous. Rathat ujo gudiyo sade tinshi daniyo rathat kona deva basege. Who is sitting in the rath? Cart. And now they say, Rathat base saibin maya janaloka disege. They said, in the cart, Fatima, saibin is there, not Shantadurga. How they change their culture, they change their religion, but not change the culture.
After Goa's liberation, Goa evolved herself into a distinct identity, an identity which was based on a fusion of Indo-Portuguese culture, Goa Indica and Goa Dorad, some people would like to call it, Golden Goa, Goa India. So that fusion had taken place. Kokni was the mother tongue of all Goans, I would say. And suddenly we find a party, political party was born called the Maharashtravadi Gomantak Paksh. And the main plank of this party was to merge Goa with Maharashtra, based on Marathi. And this party said that the language of Goans is not Kokni, but Marathi, and Kokni is a dialect of Marathi, to which we took strong objections. Kokni is an independent language. But they tried to say that Kokni is a dialect of Marathi, and Goans are all Marathi-speaking people. Every Goan spoke Kokni in their houses. But yet some people choose to say, even now, that Marathi is their mother tongue when they cannot even speak a word of Marathi. But they say that Marathi is a mother tongue, Kokni is a dialect, which we fought against that. So based on that, they wanted to merge Goa with Maharashtra. Now, another major factor why they wanted to merge Goa with Maharashtra was the party felt, and the chief minister, the first chief minister of Goa felt, he was influenced by the leaders from Maharashtra, mainly Yashwantrao Chavan, who had a great desire of enlarging Maharashtra and taking Goa into Maharashtra, one of the factors being the mining, the iron ore and the tourism. So the Maharashtrians could grow richer.
But it is the bad thing that not only Maharashtrian people want to merge in Goa, in the merge in Maharashtra, but from here also some people, very badly we say, here also people so influenced by Maharashtrian.
Why?
It is a very bad thing that they said that they feel that the Hinduism, when Maharashtra is in the Hinduism, is still that type of Hinduism in Goa also. Mm-hmm. We are doing bhajan and kirtan and dramas in Marathi in Maharashtra. So we are doing here. So we are the part of the Maharashtra. Mm-hmm. It is not true. We are not the part of the Maharashtra or the Karnataka. We have our own identity, cultural identity, geographical identity also. We are not similar to Maharashtrian. Even in lifestyle, we are near to Konkan areas. We are the Konkani peoples. By eating the fish and rice.
Because what I heard is that by trying to join forces with the Maharashtrian Hindus, the Hindu community of Goa, which was afraid of the power of the Christian community of Goa, thought that by joining forces with their Hindu brothers of the neighbor state, they would be able to win.
Maybe one point is there, even because that time also, Christian were not majority in Goa. That time also about 60-40s preparation was that 60 was Hindus and 40 was now it is a Christian is very less than 30% also. Maybe it is one fear, but it is not total like this.
So they decided to merge Goa with Maharashtra. Now, one of the major factors was the caste factor. However, people would not like to speak. I have done an analysis of that. And the caste factor, they said that these Brahmins, the elite, whether they are Hindu elite Brahmins or Christian elite Brahmins, they call them Bamon Christian and Bamon Hindus, they would swallow the remaining castes. And if they are part of Maharashtra, these Brahmins will be in a minority, and the majority would be, he called it the Bahujan Samaj, which meant the downtrodden, the all other castes other than Saraswats, the Brahmins, other than Saraswats, they are all Bahujan Samaj, and we need to fight for them, for their economic position. And they said that Marathi is the language. With these two, the caste and the language, they wanted to merge Goa with Maharashtra. And there was this freedom fighter called Purushottam Kakodkar, who lobbied at Delhi with the central leaders, first with Nehru and then with Indira Gandhi. At the time of opinion poll, Indira Gandhi was the prime minister. And he influenced the central leadership that we need to have a referendum. But they preferred to call it opinion poll and not referendum, because that referendum term was used vis-a-vis Kashmir. That term was heavily used in connection with Kashmir. So they didn't want to have that same thing here. So they said, let us, although it means sort of same, but they said, let us use the term opinion poll. And with Purushottam Kakodkar, and here in Goa, Dr. Jack Sikera, who is now hailed as the father of the opinion poll, Jack Sikera, Erasmo Sikera was his son. And Jack Sikera was the first the opposition leader in the assembly. And with his UG party, United Goans, Donpana, two leaves. It was two leaves versus the rose. So here, Jack Sikera, Erasmo Sikera, Victoria Fernandez, then Uday Bhemre, Chandrakant Keni, then Orlando Sequeira Lobo, Mauril Furtado. In fact, the entire UG party, Urminda Mashkananes Lima Laitao, all these people and so many of them, they said that Goa should remain separate. Ullas Buyao, he had a small Kalapathak, you know, and they went village to village campaigning for opinion poll. The MGP party gathered people from outside Maharashtra, deputationists who came here, and they said, Zalaj Paije. Means, we want it to happen. What they want it to happen, to Goa, merge Goa with Maharashtra. And it was such a very delicate situation on the when the opinion poll results came on the 16th January 1967 was the opinion poll. On 18th January, when the results were declared, initially, it was a very unfortunate situation that people felt that Goa would be part of Maharashtra. But when the results came from south, from Bernauli and all, then the whole thing tilted in favor of anti-mergerists. So, and people were very happy. And actually, it is a very narrow margin. 44% voted for Goa merge into Maharashtra, and 56% voted for Goa remaining a separate entity. So it was a very delicate kind of thing, and that is why I call it as a watershed in the history of Goa. Otherwise, we would have been a small district of Maharashtra like Ratnagiri. We would have been swallowed by them. And today, where we are Goans, we have a separate identity that would have been completely lost. Hats off to the opinion poll people who fought for it.
And Government of India only gave one opinion poll in 1967. After that, so many people demanded opinion poll all over India, but nobody gave them.
You know, in Goa, luckily Goa, compared to other states of India, logistically it's a small state. People by and large are literate and people know each other. So Goa has always been very active when it came to citizen movements and causes.
You know, the literacy rate is about the 100 literacy rate. The 100% is the literacy rate. Sorry. And another very important thing is there is the mass media is very powerful in Goa. Small area, and here about not less than about 6 to 7 channel. Small channel, that is not satellite, but small channel. And they go every village to village and cover the social problems, local problems. And
yeah, I think it's also in a society which is more, I think the West is losing, and I think India is also going that way, where we actually meet and talk. Now with internet and computers, gradually even our personal communications are growing less. We're getting more, okay, we can sit in front of a computer individually and communicate. But I think Goa, at least the smaller city, okay, big cities, it's maybe more difficult, but in Goa, people still talk. They go outside, meet people, they go to cafes, they go to bars, you know, they read the papers, the local press. So this has been happening over time in Goa. People have been involved in issues which are environmental or civic. But it's always been small groups fighting for small issues. It's never been one cohesive movement. And as you know, in Goa, the environmental lobbies are very strong. You have environmental groups, you have groups fighting against mining, you have social groups, groups for women, groups on consumer action. So these things are active, but all individually. Now, what happened in 2006? Earlier that year, the government came up with a regional plan, 2011. The draft was notified to the public in November of 2005. It was opened out to public. And by opening out, they just put up the plans in the town planning office and people are supposed to come and react, which most people can't. Anyhow, after that, in August of 2006, they notified it. And then a group of us, basically architects, we got together and we saw that this plan was vastly different from the plan they'd actually shown to the public. Majorly, the settlement area had increased drastically. And it had covered areas which were like the hills, the paddy fields, the coastal areas, all prime areas. And that's how it all started. And the scale was like all Goa. Till now, each problem had been like tackling maybe Panjim or another small area. This was all Goa. We got together, we called a meeting with NGOs, citizen groups, and the press. And we presented this whole thing of what this new regional plan is doing. It's basically something which is taking the people of Goa for a ride, because it's after showing it to the people, it has made so many major changes without any notification to the public. And that's on December 3rd at Don Bosco, actually. After this meeting and this presentation got over, we had visuals and slides and showed how the notified plan was different from the draft plan, you know, and the differences and the area increase. And what kind of implications it may have to Goa. After this meeting, actually, the people got together, basically NGOs and active citizens. We got together and we said, let's all put our different ideologies behind, our political differences behind, and let's all get together and fight this regional plan. So that was the Save Goa movement, the Goa Bachao Abhiyan. Heterogeneous groups, heterogeneous people got together to fight this one issue, the regional plan.
The people, it was the people's movement, it was the people's victory. People from all walks of life, men, women, and even children, students were all there in large numbers. The church played a very important role. The priest played a very important role in galvanizing the masses, the people. So people came there in large numbers. And then finally on 7th February 2007, they issued this thing saying that they are going to withdraw the regional plan.
And I think what we're talking about in Goa Bachao Abhiyan is Goa has something special, which we all, each place has, but Goa has these special characteristics.
Because Goa is special. Goa, in fact, Pandit Nehru in his May 1963 speech had acknowledged the fact that Goa has a special status. Goans should preserve their special identity, their special cultural identity, which is a little different from the rest of the country. So we want to preserve that.
So we want to develop. Everybody wants to progress. Everybody wants to have a better quality of life. But doing that, there has to be a balance between the land and between our needs. And I think that is what you're talking about. Going forward in a balanced manner. And unfortunately, the definition of both identity and development, I think, vary so much. Because for us, we see development as progress, betterment, not just construction and building more. We're talking about a better quality of life, which is our birthright, which is each person's birthright. And I think that is what. So in terms of identity, we're talking about the land and the people. And in terms of development, it's a progressive betterment of our quality of life. And I think that's what GBA stands for. And the fact that we have to take responsibility for our own lives. We have to be involved, otherwise we cannot say anything to anybody else.
So considering first the opinion poll, where Goans were fighting for a certain territory, the administration of their own territory by them and not by the neighbor states, first. Second, we have in 67, we have in 87 the language issue where Goans were fighting for their own language and again not being part of someone else's language. So they didn't want the Marathi, they wanted the Konkani, or they didn't want the Hindi or any other official language. And now they're fighting for their greenness. They don't want their greenness to be built with big hotels and big development. So I dare say that it's quite clear to identify the territory, the language, and the land, I mean the greenness. Can you add some more flavors or some more items to this kind of iconography of Goa, to this Goan mythology based on land and language?
Yeah, it is a typical Goan identity. I think we got some good things from Portuguese also. It is the politeness. How to speaking to another people. It is the politeness, and I think this is the contribution we took from the Portuguese. Even and it is politeness, not only Christianity also in Christian people also. My one friend, he was an IAS officer in Delhi, and he was connected to so many ministers of India, and he said your minister is the unique minister. It's maybe Edward Faller or Shantaram Naik. Or Mr. Ramakant Kalapur or Sripad Naik. He said that there is a different type of their behavior, it is very politeness. I don't find in any other MP easily. This is the, I think this is the unique politeness of the behavior we got from our great your Portuguese traditions, and we maintain it as a good, not because of Portuguese, but it is good. So this is the one of the identity, I think. And so the, another thing is cultural aspect is there, but is it environmental? Is in the geographical way also? We are in Konkan. It is in the border Konkan area near the sea, and our temperament is also is a very calm temperament. Not the susegad. We say the susegad means the laziness. No, susegad is the lifestyle also. I am also getting 6 o'clock getting, and Mumbai wala also getting the 4 or 5 o'clock, and we are doing same duty, but not in hurry. It is just like Bombay or in city, we are in doing slowly. That is our lifestyle. So enjoy the life also, enjoy the duty, and enjoy the our my life also.
We are very happy with the way people call us Susegad. Susegad, I do not think Susegad means lazy. Susegad means relaxed, and we would like to be relaxed. You know, any non-Goan who comes to Goa, he says, he just dismisses the Goans as, you know, 365 days on a holiday, Susegad. What do they mean by 365 days? 365 days, we are fighting for the preservation of Goa. We are not on a holiday. And if we have some moments of relaxation in the afternoon siesta, it's fine. That's the way we want to live.
Goa, quando te ouço cantar.
Goa, quando te vejo dançar. Sinto uma alegria no meu peito. Danças, és cartitas, tuas tranças são das chitas, és criança tão bonita e balanças o luar no teu palmar. Vou cantando, tristeza da minha alma.
Before I answer that, I'd like to ask you, what is identity? What do you define as Goan identity? I've been parochial, xenophobic. You say Goa for Goans, not outside. Is that Goan identity? I don't think so. So it all depends on the definition. For me, Goan identity is about the people, the land, and a balance between the people and the land. So I think it's just a question of balance about people, their needs, the land, and its resources and its carrying capacity. For me, that is Goa. It's a certain character of the place, a certain lifestyle, a certain ambiance.
It's the notion that people have in Goa that they can affect changes, which is not entirely present in the rest of the country. I think there is a certain kind of powerlessness which representative democracy has brought about in India. And in Goa, because you have these other institutions, community institutions, still fairly active at the grassroots. So it's that to reach that ideal level of democracy seems to be much more possible for people in Goa.
Neste episódio fizemos uma visita aos três momentos da história recente de Goa em que os goeses bateram o pé e lutaram pela preservação da sua cultura. Digamos que foi uma aproximação ao tema identidade de um ponto de vista histórico, político, social. No próximo episódio temos uma surpresa. Vamos falar de Bollywood. Vamos ver como é que os mídia tratam do mesmo assunto, da identidade goesa, como é que Goa tem sido representada pela indústria de cinema indiana, como é que Bollywood tem exportado a imagem das praias de Goa, dos palmares e de uma certa filosofia de vida a que os goeses chamam sossegado. Portanto, de 2 a 15 dias, não perca o próximo Contacto Goa.